In this video, we'll explore the fundamentals of a classic ignition system, we'll show you how easy it is to use a labscope for automotive diagnosis, and we'll do a little quiz at the end to help you test and consolidate your understanding.
Good morning. Well, I'm really excited to bring you this second installment of the series on how to use a labscope to make automotive diagnoses. And the topic today is secondary waveforms. Now, we're going to use the Dodge Ram in this case and look at secondary waveforms on the Dodge Ram. But even if you never see one of these again, this is important territory to cover because we're going to lay down some foundations and jargon and groundwork that you need to know to understand the next chapters. Bear with me. We're going to go through a couple of minutes of schematics, and then we're going to go to the car and look at some waveforms. Now, I need you to give me 2 minutes of your time to go over some fundamentals. The basic design of the ignition system is almost 100 years old. I'm going to show you a classic design, but you're going to see that if you know this one, you'll be able to understand almost every new variant. Here's the battery, the coil, the capacitor, the points, or in a new electronic ignition system, the electronics. Here's the distributor and one of the plugs. This is the primary side of the coil, and this is the secondary side. I find this circuit interesting because of two issues. First, look at this point right here. Unlike most transformers, the primary side is hardwired into the secondary. They call this a type of auto transformer, which turns out to be lighter, cheaper, and more powerful than the isolation transformers that came before. The second thing is the capacitor here. The capacitor was added to try and save the points, which were getting hammered with back EMF and lots of damaging oscillation sparks. Adding the capacitor smoothed out those oscillations and gave the system a kind of a tune, much like tuning that you get with a crystal radio. Now let's put an ammeter on the primary side of the coil here. Let's do a plot of current against time. Well, here's a plot of current against time. The switch closes here to allow current to flow, and it opens here to stop flow of current. That phase when the primary current is flowing is known as the dwell phase. And you know, think of the dwell as a storage phase when you store energy from a battery to be suddenly released by the spark at the end. The primary cycle begins when this switch closes to allow current to flow, and then you see current ramp up, growing with time to a plateau. Now let me ask you a question. Why doesn't it jump straight up like it would in a normal circuit? Well, it's because of a property of any coil called inductance that causes the initial energy put in to be stored in a growing magnetic field. It's a lot like pushing a heavy weight up a slope. You push like crazy without changing speed, but you end up with stored energy you can use later. As the magnetic field builds, the current ramps up to reach a saturation plateau, and at the exact moment the cylinder is ready for a spark, the switch shuts off and the primary current flow abruptly goes to ground. It's the steepness of this slope right here that makes the magic happen.
Well, that's enough theory for the moment. I've heard some mechanics describe the secondary waveforms as an ECG for a car, and that's not far from the mark. Now, the first thing you need to do is to boot up the computer, and that's the thing that takes the longest, so we'll do that now. And at the same time, we're going to hook up our sensors. Now, this first sensor I'm going to show you is a capacitive pickup device designed to measure high voltage in ignition wires, and it comes with its own ground. And all these sensors come with a standard BNC connector. And then to hook up the BNC, you just push on and then lock it into place. Of course, the engine is off and we always hook up our ground wire first for safety, and then we're going to hook up the capacitive probe to an easy plug wire. This is plug wire number 2, just the first one in the bunch. It doesn't matter which wire you use, but you got to know which one it is. Well, the great thing about the Dodge Ram is everything is easy to get to. This is the coil, and this is the secondary output that goes to the distributor, so every cylinder fires on this wire. And then this is the input, two small wires that input here. And so we're going to hook up our capacitive clamp to the output. As simple as that. Now, I'm expecting less than about 10 amps, but I don't want to overshoot because I don't want to damage any sensors down the line. This device has a power on-off switch, so we're going to power it on. And then when the Pico software is booted up, you hit the zero button, it zeros it. And then we're going to put it on. Just like that. Now you notice that I've kept wires well away from the fan belt. If a wire gets caught here, it's a disaster, so you don't want that. All right, now we need to tell our software where our sensors are hooked up. And I find there's a convenient thing here set up with Pico. You go click Automotive, Ignition, Distributor, And then this is the system I'm using is the Kinglig system, so click there. And it loads all the presets so you have your scales correctly adjusted. And then watch this, it automatically loads an instruction page if you need it. I'm going to X out of that because I know most of this. So this is just an example waveform of something you might see. Now I'm going to customize it for what I've done. And so I'm going to want A to have a little bit larger scale. So I'm going to change my scale there. To do that, I'm going to go with secondary ignition probe. And then for my scale, I'm going to have minus 5 to 50, which should put me in a safe range. Now the B channel was the King probe, and we'll do the same thing with that. It's also the secondary ignition probe. Now if you get a signal that's inverted, you just click the opposite one. This is the inverted channel and this is the regular one, so you just get used to what you're using. And then I'm going to go with the same scale, minus 5 to 50. Now I've got on the D channel, I've got hooked up the amp probe, and so we're just going to do that. And it's the 60 amp mode of the 60 amp probe. And we're going to adjust the scale there. You can do it automatic if you want. I'm going to go minus 5 to 20 to give me a pretty good range. So now we're set up. Okay, now it's recording here. Now we're triggering off the second cylinder. And I have written down the firing order here somewhere. 2, 1, 8, 4. And then the rest of them. Now look at cylinder number 4. You gotta think something's wrong there.
For this next part, you need to know a little bit of jargon, which will make this so much easier to understand. Here's an example secondary voltage waveform with voltage of a single ignition event on a spark plug wire plotted on the y-axis and time on the x-axis. The red arrow shows when electrons first jump across the plug gap. You'll recall that during the dwell phase, current ramps up on the primary side of the coil, storing energy in a magnetic field. When current in the primary is abruptly turned off, the magnetic field collapses, releasing a huge firing voltage spike. But here's the thing, that voltage will spike up exactly to the point that there's enough energy to jump over the easiest path to ground. So if you've got a big gap, it takes more energy to jump across and firing voltage will be higher. Does that make sense? And if you have a small gap or an alternate path to ground, firing voltage will be lower. I've got three specific terms for you. Firing voltage is the peak of the voltage spike at the instant the first electrons leap across the plug gap. Spark voltage is the measured voltage when the rest of the electrons follow suit. And burn time is the duration of the spark. Firing voltage typically measures between 8 and 20 kV, but that height is very challenging to measure accurately, because an oscilloscope randomly samples voltage, and if it doesn't happen to be measuring at the instant of the highest spike, you get a lower reading. So firing voltage typically varies quite a bit from beat to beat. After those first electrons jump the gap, gases are ionized, so resistance breaks down. So as following electrons leap across the gap, you get a lower plateau of voltage called the spark voltage. Don't get those two mixed up. The burn time, which is the duration of the spark firing, typically lasts 1 to 2 milliseconds. You'll see it's a bit short here. Well, here's a clinical pearl. There's only so much energy built up in the coil, so if it uses more energy to cross a big gap, then there'll be less available for burn time. Many things that cause a big firing voltage will also cause a short burn time. And burn time is one of those parameters that is much easier for an oscilloscope to measure and compare. So that's the one your eye should be drawn to first. What if both burn time and firing voltage are low? Well, then you're not getting as much energy as you should from the coil, and you need to investigate the coil on the primary wiring. Now let's focus a little closer on the plateau of spark voltage during the spark plug burn. One of the tricks technicians use is to divide the plateau into two phases with a line down the middle as I've done here. In general, if an abnormality is present in the first part of the plateau, you've got a problem in something outside the cylinder, including plugs, but also wires, rotor, etc. And if the problem is confined to the latter part of the plateau, it's an issue inside the cylinder. Notice how there's a normal uptick of voltage at the end. That's thought to be from a reduction of conductivity as fuel is used up. However, if you see an exaggerated upswing at the end, consider the possibility of a lean cylinder. Lean cylinders tend to burn hot, and it's not uncommon for that extra heat to cause secondary problems like coil-on-plug failure, etc. Of course, if the problem is secondary, you've not solved the problem by just replacing the failed part. All right, that's enough theory for the moment. Let's have some fun. I'm going to do something to this vehicle, and then we're going to look at the secondary waveforms, and I want you to tell me what I did to the car.
Here's a challenge. It should be fun. I'm going to show you four waveforms. We'll call them waveform A, B, C, D. I actually recorded five, but I couldn't see any abnormality when I used a big plug gap of 90 thousandths. You want to match them up to the following problems list, and you can't use a problem or waveform more than once.
So we're going to call this waveform A for our little game. Now normally at the car I do these measurements all at the car and look at it myself, but with the extra noise and vibration and reflections, I've saved the file and brought it indoors so we can work out it indoors and make it easier for you to see. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to pull the primary amperage out of the context because we don't need that for this analysis. And we're triggering on the second cylinder, which is the blue channel right here. And so if this is cylinder number two, we know from the firing order that this is cylinder number four. Now the first thing that jumps out at you is the huge firing voltage on cylinder number four. Look at how big it is. And of course, the first thing I would think of is whether or not that's an artifact. And so let's scroll between pages and see if in successive pages it's a consistent finding. And indeed it is. It's the same all the way through. Now let's measure it. We can take these sliders, and Pico does the math for you, so you just have to align the two sliders and it does the arithmetic, which is kind of nice. And so we've got 49.6 kilovolts, so we know the coil is putting out a lot of energy, 49.6 kilovolts. Now let's zoom in here. We'll just look at this part of the curve here so we can measure the burn time. And move this thing out of the way. So you can see the burn time is really short as well. Let's measure that. So extreme firing KV and short burn time. What do you think that might be? And the burn time is a bit hard to measure, but 0.4 milliseconds, 405 microseconds. And then the spark voltage is really high as well. I'm not going to measure that. So what do you think the diagnosis with this one is? This is waveform B. I must say that at idle there was no abnormality I could see, but I think you can clearly see there's an abnormality with snap throttle. Let's zoom in on this. Now I should mention that we're triggering on cylinder number two, so you should be able to work out which is a bad cylinder. Let's zoom in a little bit. We'll show you the burn line. So there's the burn line right there. What's the diagnosis? Let's go on to waveform C. I'm going to scroll you through some screens here and see if you can see a pattern coming out. Again, this is cylinder 2 right here. So let's just scroll through. It may be hard for you to pick out. I want you to look at the firing voltage on these. And then we go on to a snap throttle. Now let's zoom in a bit and see what we see on the firing line. And I think you can appreciate the burn time here is quite a bit longer than the burn time with a normal cylinder. Just measure that for you. .97, so still in the normal range, but the others are about 1.2. So a long burn time, short firing voltage, and a short spark voltage. What's the diagnosis? Okay, this is waveform D. If I scroll through the screens here, I think you'll appreciate that the firing voltage on this cylinder is a bit abnormal. We're again triggering on cylinder number two. Not much to say otherwise. Let's zoom in here. You can see both the firing voltage and also the spark voltage a little bit lower than average, and I think you'll appreciate that the burn time is a little bit longer as well. Not dramatically so though. So what's our diagnosis here? 1.8, whereas on the others it's about 1.4. Well, until you see this kind of thing in practice, it's hard for what you read in books to sink in into pure knowledge. Now I'm going to leave the discussion of what the answers are for this little quiz for the discussion. I'm sure it'll be easier for most of you. Now there are two issues that came to mind when I did this. The first is that in the setting of a lean cylinder with a snap throttle, the actual shape of that curve, it's more the shape than anything else, is what really twigs the diagnosis. And then the second thing was that I was surprised that with a dead short, the pattern you get is actually fairly close to normal. And the reason for that, of course, is that in the distributor, there's also a gap. And electrically, the electrons don't know where the gap is, but it's there. And so the distributor takes over, and that's what you see. It'd be interesting to see what the pattern is with an electronic ignition, and that'll be the topic for future videos. Let's go back now and talk about the original problem in this car. Finally, now that we have some experience with what normal is, let's go back to what was originally found in this vehicle. You recall that spark plug number 4 looked quite abnormal, and this is a magnified view of this. And if you watch me scroll through the frames, you'll see that it's normal on some occasions, and then abnormal on others. Intermittent problem there on that fourth cylinder. There are no codes in this vehicle, and I really didn't detect any specific abnormality. Now let's zoom in a little bit and see. You can see the firing voltage is about normal, maybe a little low, but about normal. And look at that hash. And importantly, I think it's on the first part of the firing line. So a high spark voltage and a lot of hash in that first part of the firing line. And if we measure the burn time, you'll see the burn time is significantly shorter than in a normal cylinder. What do you think the problem is? So the burn time is 0.6 milliseconds. Well, I'll tell you what I did. I took out and removed and replaced that spark plug, and at least electrically the problem is solved. What went through my mind is the question about whether some abnormality in that fourth cylinder has led to that spark plug being fouled, or whether it was just a bad plug out of the box. The plugs aren't all that old. I wondered about whether or not I might have a lean cylinder, but when we look at the pattern afterwards, I'm not seeing any abnormality. There's certainly no evidence of a lean cylinder there. I think at this point I may move on to doing compression testing and a leak down test on that fourth cylinder just to better clarify what's happening in the fourth cylinder, but for now the car seems to be functioning fine. Say, if this video helped you out and you want to see more of them, then hit like or subscribe or leave a comment. I'd love to hear what I say. Thanks for watching.